yours forever. For he is good, he is above all things, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever.
Victory is yours.
when you're lost at sea. I will illuminate everything. No need to be frightened by intimacy. Just throw off your fear and come running to me. Oh, 'cause I loved you before.
And all that Good morning and welcome to St John's online service. I'm just so glad that you could join us today. It's been quite a week and I've been really encouraged actually by a number of things that are happening. We've actually had 73 people sign up for our learning streams, which is absolutely fantastic news. And I was so encouraged by the success of that. But I also want to say a huge, huge thank you to the 61 folks who joined us for our online prayer time last Sunday night. This will be the first of many, and we will be repeating this time, but I was so encouraged by the numbers, and I was so encouraged by what was shared and the time of prayer that we had. So thank you so much for that. Later on in our service, Andy will be continuing us in our series in Isaiah, and Kate and Alan will be helping us in worship, and I'm really looking forward to the rest of this morning. It is without doubt difficult times that we're living through. I don't know about you, but I've had times when I've really hit some very low points in my life, and at times like that I attempt to catastrophize. But one of the passages in scripture that's really helped me, and we've been sharing this a little bit in our staff devotions on a Monday, is the passage in Mark 4, where in Mark 4 verse 35, where Jesus actually and calls his disciples to follow him across the lake. And we know the story so well, don't we? They hit a storm, and the storm is really raging, and I guess putting ourselves in that story can be quite helpful, because I think sometimes I must feel like those disciples in that boat. But it's really interesting to me that the questions that firstly the disciples asked Jesus, and secondly, the questions that Jesus asked the disciples, which are questions which I think could be really helpful to us and really penetrating. A friend of mine just said just recently that a good question is not something that's easily answered. In fact, he says sometimes a really good question, you can't answer it. And I heard another comment from somebody else recently who said that a fairly new Christian actually said, I found that that I don't read the Bible. It's like the Bible reads me. And I must admit, when I come to the questions that Jesus asks in the scripture, the questions that we find in scripture, sometimes it's a really good thing to put ourselves in the story and to ask ourselves those questions. And there are two questions just before we start our service that I'd like us to look at this morning. And they both appear in this passage where Jesus calms the storm. The first question is the one that the disciples asked Jesus. Do you not care? As they woke him up, they said, do you not care? We're perishing. Do you not care? And you know, that's a really, really good question. It's a good question in terms of apologetics. But honestly, it's a good question that often as Christians we're confronted with. It might, I don't know where your circumstances are this morning, but there might have been times, I guess, when you, like me, have asked the question, God, where are you in this? Do you not care? And the second question that we come across is the one that Jesus then asks his disciples after he's calmed the storm. It's this: why are you afraid? Why are you so afraid? And I have to admit, there have been times in my life, and there are times in many of our lives, when we face situations which seem quite incomprehensible to us, that question, why are you so afraid, is a really, really good question to ask ourselves. And I think whether we're facing these questions or not, well, I think one of the things that really strikes me about this is that Jesus was with his disciples in the storm. It's okay to ask questions. It's okay to have doubts. Jesus can accommodate all our questions and all our doubts. And I think one of the most exciting verses in the Bible is actually in Mark 5, verse 1, where after Jesus calmed the storm, we read, verse 1 says, and they got to the other side. You know, this is a very difficult time that we're in. It's a very stormy time. And it's one that I think my heart sank a few weeks ago when I thought, is this not going to end? You know, I said in March that it might be another year ago, a year before we get to meet together in person. And now in September, moving into October, it suddenly dawned on me that actually it might not even be March when we get to meet together. And I felt complete desolation. And there were all sorts of questions I was asking. Do you not care? But the fact is that Jesus does care. And he invites us to journey with him. And he promises not to abandon us in the storm. He promises to go through the storm with us. And I think this is a promise for you this morning. And it's a promise that I've taken to my heart this week. And it's a promise that I hope as you listen to the service and hear Andy speak about how God speaks to us and how God spoke of old and how God still speaks today. It's a promise that we need to take on board. And they reached the other side. This storm will end. And we will have the joy one day of looking back and seeing all that we've been through and of knowing that Jesus was in it with us. This storm will end, and I'm looking forward to that day. And I know it will happen, but I know that when it does, that with all our doubts and with all our questions, we will come out the other side a lot stronger, and our faith will be even stronger. In fact, I really don't know how people that are not Christians, how people that are not followers of Jesus, face some of the circumstances that life throws at them. But this one thing I do know, that God is with us, even with our questions and even with our doubts. Let's just pray. Father, I just want to thank you this morning for that picture in scripture of the storm and the fact that you didn't leave the disciples on their own. You were in the boat with them. And I thank you in the midst of all the storms we face now, of COVID, of fear, of loss of job, of bereavement, of questions that we might have, of doubts that we might face. Father, I thank you that you don't condemn us for that, but you promise to be with us in the storm with us, and you promise to bring us the other side. So Father, I pray this morning that as we take part in this service, as we listen to this service, as we engage with it, that our faith will grow and that our hope will be renewed, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello, welcome back to the Church Channel. How are you? Good to see you there. My name is Andy Clark. I'm the youth worker here, and welcome to our online service. Now we're looking at the book of Isaiah today, more specifically the 6th chapter. But before we get into that, we're going to hear the church news. And this is going to be the quickest church news on record, because at the moment in time, there's not a lot happening.
Church news like real news, but happy.
The first thing to say at the church news is we had 73 people do the courses between Me and God, Christian, and Theology 101. It was great to have such an amazing turnout. And the second thing to say is it was so cool to see you on the prayer event, which happened last Sunday night. There was 61 people, which was counted by Ruth McNinch, all the different families and people on Zoom. So it was so cool to have you there. And it will be the first of many as we just continue to talk about vision, pray together in the new world.
News, but happy.
Our worship is done today by Alan and Kate and Isla. And it's just a little note to say as well, this was recorded on Tuesday before the new legislation came in. So, over to you guys.
gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love.
Now, last week we heard from Sam Marshall talking about a time that he'd heard from God. And this week, there was a conversation recorded between Stuart and Ross Morgan, just talking about different times in their life where he's heard God speak and how that's changed the course of action that he's went on in his life. So that clip will play, and then immediately on to it'll be my sermon talking about Isaiah chapter 6. So over to you guys.
Hi Ross, how are you doing this afternoon?
I'm alright, Stuart. Good to see you.
Good. Thank you for agreeing to do this little interview with us. We're doing it now for Sunday morning. So we're doing the Then and Now series, which is based on Isaiah, and we're talking a little bit about how God speaks to us. And we had Sam Marshall talk to us last week a little bit about one of his story, and just thank you for coming on today and just telling us a little bit about how you've heard from God, and the couple of stories that you've had. If you would just go ahead and share that with us now, that'd be great.
Sure. Yeah, I think one of the things I find is God often speaks in the most unextraordinary of fashions. And I think often he's speaking perhaps all the time in whispers, and I'm sometimes listening. But there are perhaps a few stories that, from things that have been more significant times in my life, and I'll maybe come to a more simple story at the end. Certainly I remember when I was 17, shortly after becoming a Christian, I never thought about the notion of God speaking to you. I thought that sounded a bit spooky. But shortly after becoming a Christian, about 6 months or so after, I felt a very strong impression. That's perhaps all I can describe it as, impression from God, that I had to get involved in doing some youth work. Now, at that time, there was absolutely no youth work happening in Bathgate at all. So it was quite an odd thing to perhaps hear or feel moved towards. But I do remember, those early days of really needing to know I had heard from God, because it was really quite tough trying to get something started with limited support. And really that kind of came through, I would say, an impression more than anything else. God just suggesting, putting a real kind of burden on my heart for particularly for teenagers who'd never heard the gospel. It was the main reason that I chose to live in Bathgate rather than move to Edinburgh, as most of my friends were doing when they went off to university. So there was definitely something that happened, because had that not happened, I would have moved in a flat in Edinburgh, I'd have moved in with some friends, that would have been the obvious path. So something certainly had to have happened to have changed that particular course. A few years later, after I graduated from university, as I was getting towards that kind of point of graduating, you're wondering what job you should do. And, you often think God will, if it's God that's speaking, it'll be okay. Well, you have to be a church pastor or a missionary or something in those kind of ilk. So it was quite a surprise to me to have a prophetic word about entering the electronics industry. Now, it wasn't a surprise to do electronics industry. I studied electronics at university. But there was one particular, there's a number of different companies all over Scotland I was looking at. But there's one particular company in Edinburgh that God really singled out. And I remember I had never been in really too many what you might call prophetic meetings before. So I was quite nervous. But there was a chap speaking and sharing some prophetic words with people. And he spoke what he sensed God saying to me. And it really struck me about being placed in this a very particular workplace. That really was one of these, the workplace indeed that I'm still in, all about being a force for good there, a force for change, and really his words to see the impossible become possible. And that really was a motivating factor for that decision in my life. Mm. And a third one, and I'll maybe share one ordinary one after that. A third one was when I first was thinking, or when my wife and I were going to get married. I'm currently in Cullen on holiday just now, and my daughter asked me the other day, why did you decide to get married in Cullen rather than Bathgate or in Edinburgh? And I said, well, Joe and I just were discussing one. I said, well, we should probably pray about this. We keep arguing. We'll pray. And just instantly the word Cullen, so a really straight confirmation came ahead, Cullen. Came into our heads. And so again, they were probably more life-changing kind of points, where you really know that God is directing you, and that'd be three significant ones. But just this week, and I find this is the way that God speaks to me more than anything else, is just simply through simple impressions you get when you're reading your Bible. It's not dramatic, it's not the most amazing of stories often, but it's often the ones that are the perhaps most important. And I was just reading the other day in Colossians 3, it says, since then you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. And I think, like many people at the moment, it's very easy to get totally taken in by your work and life balance has become really merged at the moment. And I just really sense just that simple verse, God's reminding me, don't think all about the earthly things. You work all the time. It's very easy. You have to have your mind instead focused on him, focusing on heavenly things.
Thank you so much, Ross, for being with us today and for sharing. And we'll catch you later. See you later.
Thanks.
Every good story needs an origin story, and that's no different for Isaiah. Isaiah's origin story isn't found at the start of the book, but it's found within the sixth chapter. And he's in the temple, and he's going about his business, and the Lord appears to him with fire and with smoke and with terror. Let's hear read these words from Isaiah 6:1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting high up upon the throne, and the train of his robes filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim, each had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, Holy, 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 the whole earth is filled with his glory. And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who was called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And then one of the seraphim flew to me, and taking tongs from the altar, and he touched my mouth with a coal and said, Behold, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for. Now what happens here for Isaiah is a thing called a theophany, and that means that God literally entered the world at this literal time to speak to Isaiah. It wasn't a vision, it wasn't a dream. God turned up in fire and smoke to Isaiah to speak to him. But what was the world which God turned up to? What was the situation in Isaiah's time which he is speaking into? Well, it says in 6 chapter 1 that in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Now, King Uzziah, if we were to put him broadly within the categories of good king or bad king, he would unfortunately come in a bad king for Israel. He had made pacts with Israel's enemies to wage war on others. He'd forgotten the place of the widow and the orphan and the alien within their society. And Israel, such a land of promise and hope at the beginning, he had helped that turn around for evil. And in fact, Uzziah died in disgrace because he was in the temple, walking where he shouldn't have, where only the priests should go. And he died in division and disgrace. But within the backdrop of that, the old king passes away and the real king shows up. And more than that, he shows up in the place where Uzziah shouldn't have been. And he speaks directly to Isaiah. And this theophany happens within this world. It records that the thresholds of the temple shook. There is tongs taken from the literal altar that is there in the temple. That there's smoke and there is fire, and God's saying that he is here and he is holy. So God enters this world that Isaiah is in and he speaks to it. And this is the first prophecy next that we're about to hear. And it's not a prophecy of sunshines and rainbows and smiles. It is a prophecy of judgment. Listen here to the first prophecy that Isaiah must say to the nation. Keep on hearing and do not understand. Keep on seeing and do not perceive. Make the hearts of the people dull and their ears heavy. Bind their eyes, and lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed. And then Isaiah said to them, How long, O Lord? And he said, Until cities lie waste without inhabitant, and houses without people, and the land is a desolate waste. And the Lord removes his people far away to the forsaken places, are many in the midst of the land. And though a tenth remain in it, it will be burned again, like a timberinth or an oak whose stump remained. When it is felled, the holy seed is its stump. Now this isn't a happy prophecy that Isaiah first has to say. This is actually the main sounding alarm to go into exile. God is sending his own people into exile. That's right, God has turned up to Isaiah and told them that the worst possible thing possible has happened, that they will be removed from their own homeland and they will be taken away to Babylonia. They will be ridden off into some other place. They will have to leave all that they are known. It is terrible. But the thing that Isaiah understands about God is that God is a God of judgment. The ball that Isaiah catches is one where it understands what judgment is. He understands that things can go so far for so long until they need to stop. This God is a God of consequence. He's not just one that allows people to forever go on and on and on in sin, but he's one that turns up and goes, that's enough. Things must change. Things must be different. And there are consequences to your actions. Now that sounds like a text of despair. And so far you might be thinking, Andy, this sounds like a sermon of utter despair. But there is hope even at the end of this passage. If we look at the last couple of verses on chapter 6, it says, although a tenth remain in it, it will be burned again like a timberinth or an oak. But then it says, whose stump remained even when it felled, the holy seed is its stump. Now right at the very end of what we see here is that God is saying, although I lead you out, although things will happen to you that are difficult, although there is consequences to your actions of sin, that it will not crush you forever, and that I will bring about redemption again from the seeds of derision that have been sown. I will bring about new life from the old ways of doing stuff. I will bring about new and beautiful things. And although that you have forgotten the alien and the orphan and the widow, you will again remember them. And O Israel, you will remember, you are a land of great promise again. Isaiah understands and throws forward to us this God of judgment. This God who says enough is enough with your sin. And also a God who says to us, even though you've messed up, even though you've went astray, I will redeem you. And he throws that to us. And we do a funny thing in the New Testament when we think about judgment, don't we? When we think about judgment in the New Testament, we classically say that God doesn't care very much about it. And now we've just moved into the time of redemption. And you see that the way as Christians kind of divide themselves up. We see people who take judgment very, very seriously. Consequences to actions, cause and effect of the things that we do because God is holy. And then we see people on the other side who talk about a God all of grace. But actually, when the ball's caught by Jesus in the New Testament, when it comes to judgment, God is very, very serious in it. In Matthew 5, it tells us, if your right eye causes you to sin, cut it out, for it's better to lose that than your whole body in hell. And he really means it, and he means verses like it. But if you're serious about judgment, you have to equally be serious about redemption. And now we don't think about this often, but what an act of judgment and what an act of redemption for God to see this world and to send his one and only son into the midst of it. It reads at the start of Matthew, it says, the land of Zebulun, the land before Naphtali, the land of the sea beyond the Jordan, the Galilee of nations. The people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. For those dwelling in the region of the shadow of death, the light has dawned.
If we're serious about the God of judgment that we see, we must be equally serious about the redemption and the hope that is found in him. For many people have tried to divorce him of the redemption or the judgment, but it's the marrying of these two things, judgment and redemption, which we see the fullest picture of Jesus. It's we see in the fullest extent what Isaiah threw to us, and we now catch that God is a God of judgment, yes, but he is one of redemption and hope. Last October, which seems like a lifetime ago, I went to a conference in Belfast. It was a 24/7 prayer conference, and the weekend had been about prayer, etc., etc. And they always do something interesting on the final night. So the final night of this was an auction for badly knitted vests. Yes, you did hear me correctly. Badly knitted vests that were auctioned off for the betterment of others in St. Anne's Cathedral in Belfast. So, I go to the place, they are serving alcohol. I have a beer. And then this strange auction takes place where people's vests are auctioned off for different projects and different people connected to the 24/7 prayer movement. But the final auction of the night goes to a woman who's Canadian. And this Canadian woman had been homeless for the majority of her life. She'd been addicted to drugs and alcohol. She was at the end of the road. And she'd been given a ticket to come to this conference by some chance event. I think she just became a Christian and they'd sent her on this conference. And the last vest was auctioned for her benefit. So I'm in the room and there's 200 people around me who this person doesn't know any of them. I don't know her, etc. So the bidding starts. £500. £1,000. £2,000. And it's back and forth, and I begin to fixate my eyes on this woman that I can see, this Canadian woman, and then the price begins to go up and up. £3,000, £4,000, £5,000, and the two main bidders look at each other in this strange Christian auction for badly knitted vests, and they walk right up to each other and they have this conversation together. And I am standing there perplexed. This is the strangest event I have ever went to in my whole life. And the two people have this conversation together and they turn around and unanimously combined their money together and they went £10,000. And the whole of Belfast Arena erupts and my eyes look at this woman who has had this badly knitted vest auctioned off on her behalf, and she just received £10,000 so she can restart her life in Canada. Now, that woman had received the just reward for the lifestyle that she'd lived. She had received the just award for the cards that she was dealt. We have to be serious about the judgment and the causality of our actions, but holy smokes, if we are serious about the causality of our actions, we must be serious too about the God of redemption and hope. The God of redemption and hope who longs to give good gifts to his children. So if we catch this ball, as I long we will do today, we must catch a ball of judgment and hope.
Savior with me. There's no need to cover what I already see. You've got your reasons, but I hold your peace. You've been on lockdown and I hold the key. 'Cause I loved you before you knew what was love. I saw it all. Still I chose the cross. You were the one that I was thinking of when I rose from the grave. Now rid of the shackles, my victory is yours. I will illuminate everything. No need to be frightened by intimacy. Just throw off your fear and come running to me. Oh, 'cause I loved you before. You knew what was love, and I saw it all. Still, I chose the cross, and you were the one that I was thinking of when I rose from the grave. Now, rid of the shackles, my victory is yours. I tore the veil for you to come close. There's no reason to stand at a distance anymore.
That is all that we have time for today. Thank you so much for joining us with our online service. Kate is just about to play us out. May all our exiles lead us back home. May judgment hold hands with redemption. May we learn to live a life with Christ. And may we never, ever, ever forget how much he loves us and how much he longs to bring us home. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let us bring all of life to all of God. Amen.
Stretched arm, his love endures forever. safe here with me. There's no need to cover what I already see. You've got your reasons, but I hold your peace. You've been on lockdown and I hold the key. 'Cause I loved you before, you knew what was love. I saw it all, still I chose the cross. You were the one that I was thinking of when I rose from the grave. Now rid of the shackles, my victory is yours. I tore the veil for you to come close. There's no reason to stand at a distance anymore. You're not far. When you're lost at sea, I will illuminate everything. No need to be frightened by intimacy. Just throw off your fear and come running to me. Oh, 'cause I loved you before, you knew what was love. with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever.